Ajay Srivastava, Managing Director at Dimensions Corporate Consulting, is joining us right now on the show. Ajay, very good morning to you. Good time to speak to you. We've got record highs for the equity markets. Everything's going well for a year that started off on an extremely wobbly footing. Towards the end of it, it looks like it's sorted itself out. But now we need to look into the future, probably into next year. Do you see the same themes playing out as they played out in 2019?
Well, you're right. The Nifty at record highs, Delhi temperature at record lows. So all is looking good in the life. We're having a good winter, a good stock market, so everything goes well. And I think we have two people to thank for it. If you like, at the end of the day, who would you thank for the whole situation for an equity investor? I think two people you've got to really thank for. One is in India, one is abroad. One is, of course, Mr. Trump, who's ensured the fact that global liquidity is abundantly available to anybody to invest. It's a risk on. US is doing well, leading the whole world higher. I think so you need to thank him. Second, of course, our honorable finance minister, because without that tax cut, the equity market could have been in a very different shape altogether. Now, we can argue on the merits of it, whether the right thing to do, whether it will lead to benefits in the end, or it will be splurged like Mr. Munjal splurged around with saying, playing with his golf with his buddies in Bahamas and spending the good money of government tax cut given to him. Now, that's a different matter. But for whatever thing, for the time being, that is where the trigger came for the big fill up to the COP market. So two people to thank for it. Fundamentally, I know you all know the economy. Nothing is to be said about it. It's going to get worse. I think it's definitely going to get worse in the first quarter of the next year because that's off the peak season. This is the highest consumption season for the economy. Next year, next quarter is not so. So if this is the state of where we are in demand, next quarter is going to be really grim. Plus, there'll be the tax collection issues coming up that they, you know, tax man will be ensuring that whatever little money corporates have, they will be trying to take it away before the budget. So you got about 30 days, 40 days more for this tax collection drive to come through. So I think all in all, on the economy side, not a very great news. Stock market, thanks to tax cut, great going into the new years.
Ajay, you know, the budget's going to be the focus of attention now. And if you go by hearsay and the murmurs that are doing rounds, it's that more money can come into the hands of the general public, which could then spur some spending. And that in turn could spur consumption, which up until now has been suffering. So do you feel that that could be a trigger?
Well, it could be a reasonable trigger, but I think the joker in the pack is not inflation. Now, no matter how much all the analysts can downplay vegetable inflation, milk prices, oil is at $65, is not going down, and with the economy moving up, it's going to go up. All the metal prices are on the way up. You see copper on a seven-month high. So at the end of the day, I think the spoiler in the game is going to be inflation. Inflation is going to be really high in the next quarter or so. So I'm not exactly sure whether tax cut, of course, you know, everybody gets a little more money, but if you have everything at price has gone up, you're really where you are in the consumption cycle. So I think in terms of GDP, I don't think so the tax cut is going to make a difference because and of course, you know, you've got to use the rise deflator. You just can't keep using WPI. If you use CPI as a deflator, your growth in the economy was 1% for the last quarter, maybe even negative for the next quarter. So for the stock market, yes, a little fill up, but I'm not sure whether for the economy is going to be a great deal altogether. Having said that, I think one of the key things which happened yesterday was a tremendous move into riskier stocks. I think that's what the trigger was yesterday. It was no more safety. It was no more the large caps. It was no more the banking alone. I think what was happening yesterday was that the lesser known names came into focus. So I think that could be the watch point to see what happens to these stocks as demand keeps, you know, kind of doesn't move up, but the valuations have moved up already.
Mm. Ajay, good morning. So with an assumption that we do not know which way the economy is headed, I wonder if you would be positioning your portfolio slightly more aggressively because earnings might be there because of the corporate tax cut and financials are anyways doing well, or would you be a lot more defensive in your portfolio positioning?
See, we are defensive to the extent that we have exposure, reasonable exposure to pharma. We are an IT, so we are defensive to that extent. But I would not be defensive for Indian stock because I think if you see, you know, without being philosophizing about what the politics of the deal is, if you see the trajectory of government policy, it is going to be that more concessions are going to come to the corporates, whether rightfully, wrongfully, correctly used, I'm not arguing the fact. And you may see a dividend distribution tax being taken off or at least reduced to that extent. And to large extent, I think there'll be a lot of benefit flowing to the larger of the corporates in which we most of us are invested. By and large, I don't think so. Nobody has a large portfolio now focused upon so-called earlier alpha creator, the small cap or the mid cap, which is not a great place to be to start with. I don't think that is going to be the story for next year. Story for next year is going to be more concessions for the large corporates, and that is where if your portfolio is. So we are aggressively positioned with high investments in most of the large companies. I think a small cap portfolio would be not even 2 to 3% of this one. Maybe there is an alpha there, but I don't think so that's going to play out as the economy stumbles and the government focus on the large corporates.
Okay. The other bit is, and much chewed about topic, Ajay, but would love to get your perspective because at times you play contrarian. Do you reckon for the long haul, telcos are just about taking off, or do you believe a large portion of the up move is done and the risk reward is not in favor? Why or why not?
Okay, we are invested in telcos and we believe that this is just the starting point, because now you are on a threshold of an economy called India with literally a duopoly. You know, Vodafone, I would say, would eventually sell out because it's very clear they have no interest in India, neither they have a path to profitability, neither the Aditya Birla Group has a wherewithal to manage and compete with Reliance and Airtel. So I think if you look at the scenario going forward, two companies controlling the entire telecom business, now how much more profitable can be? Yes, there can be short-term issues and liquidity and so on and so forth. And you already seen now Airtel is taking the ramp up by saying, I'm going to fund it, I'm going to pay my AGR dues. Now the gauntlet is down to Vodafone to see if Airtel pays the dues, what happens to Vodafone? If it doesn't pay, what the government is going to do with Vodafone and the kind of interest liability which will mount up Vodafone. So looking at a scenario of two-player industry of such critical importance, Neeraj, there is no way but supernormal profits are coming to them. And as I said to you, that the structure is such that there is no way a third player can or fourth player can come into the system at this point of time. So I think if I were a player, we have invested ourselves and we continue to advise customers, say, telecom has become like banking, a two-race horse. Now maybe three axes may come in, but HDFC, Kotak took the two-race horse. HDFC took the housing finance game out there. Same is going to happen to telecom. Jio and this are going to clean out this market and make the kind of money which you've not even heard of. So I think my view, Airtel is just the starting. It's going to be a fantastic journey ahead. Everything is priced in, the risk, the issue, the intensity, the government legislation, everything, all the litigation is now factored in, it's on the table. You can't see another new risk factor coming in the next 5 years or so. So I think it's all going to be bountiful cash now flowing through the system.
Any niche themes, Ajay, that you feel can work well in 2020? And also, we've been seeing a lot of interest in the IPO market of late and the kind of new listings that we've seen this year. Next year is going to kickstart with one of the bigger IPOs, SBI Cards. Do you feel that there could be a possibility, at least from a short-term basis, to suck out liquidity on the back of this IPO?
No, see, IPOs have been great because if you look at even digital company like Affle, it's done phenomenally well. So by and large, IPOs of decent companies have done very, very well for most investors, and ICICI have done very well. So I think IPO market is going to be good, and if a couple of unicorns come into play, whether it's Baiju or other thing, is going to really rev up the market. So I think it's going to be a great 2020 for IPOs. There is enormous appetite for people, including new themes which will come into the market. So I think IPO wise, we are in a very comfortable zone. The point you asked was, is there a niche available in the system to kind of generate super returns? You know, my guess is that metals, non-ferrous metal is going to be the answer, because any turnaround is going to be in the favor of non-ferrous metals. I believe that ferrous will have a rough ride because now there are stronger and stronger players coming into the market, and therefore the fight and competition will be intense. Just like you've seen in cement, as the market panned out, five, six big players the returns have just normalized to a level which, of course, the economy has not done great for them either. But the fact is, nobody is going to make supernormal returns. Right? Same is going to happen in this sector in terms of Ferris, because now the big players with big balance sheets sitting there, and therefore one would believe that the non-Ferris side would be the sector which will give far superior returns, including dividend returns in the next year. So if you were to look for one sector which I think is off the line is the non-Ferris, that's going to give, I think, a very handsome return.
Okay. Ajay, much appreciate you taking the time out today and accommodating our interview request. Thanks so much.
Thank you very much, Neeraj.
In case we don't speak before, wishing you a great new year.
Always a pleasure. Thank you so much. And all to all of you as well. It's been a great year. Thank you very much.
Yes, it has been.